everyone. Thank you for attending tonight's school committee meeting. Could you please join me in saluting the flag? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. Next item is the hearing of visitors, and I've been informed that no one has signed up to speak tonight. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, thank you. Okay, next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. The consent agenda is matters of routine business bundled in a group. Any member of the school committee can choose to have an item or items taken out for further discussion. Is there anyone on the committee that would like to remove any particular item? Mr. Sullivan.
Item E.
Okay, great. We will take out, we will remove item E. Anyone else? Okay. Can I then have a motion from someone with regard to items A, B, C, D, F, and G?
Motion to accept items A, B, C, D, F, and G.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. DiAgostino. Thank you, Lisa. Okay. Any further discussion on the motion? No further discussion? All in favor? None opposed? Okay. Mr. Sullivan, item E, acceptance of donation to school supply drive.
I just wanted to mention a couple of people's names that have donated. Number one was Gary Pearson and his sister Paula Gillette. Both are graduates of Brockton Public Schools, and what they did was just give back to the schools. Julie DeSantis Rosa, she's a captain of the security of the Brockton Housing Authority. She lives at 347 North Warren Ave. Made a real big donation. David Texera of the Mattress Maker on 200 Montello Street in Brockton also gave a big donation. I just wanted to mention that David Texera is also doing a fundraiser at the Angelo School this Thursday. And number five was Tim Cruz, the district attorney of Plymouth County, also gave a donation. And a special thanks to all the people who gave, including Lisa Plant. And a special thanks to Mr. Fred Walsh at the Brockton Housing Authority and all his people. Thank you. I move that we accept item E as written.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor? Great. That's wonderful, Mr. Sullivan. The generosity of many Brocktonians is deeply appreciated, and obviously these are kind people who have donated to our students who will certainly use the material, so that's wonderful. Excellent. Okay, next item, communication. First day of school. Some were happy, some were sad to start school today. Which one are you, Madam Superintendent?
I was very happy.
Okay.
I couldn't believe that when you talk about the first day of school, we were honestly looking at the possibility of a tropical storm. It wasn't going to be a hurricane, but I think most of us here are concerned when you hear about high winds and trees that are impacted by the drought we've had this past summer. So believe me, as the weather forecast unfolded, I was pleased we were able to get school in today. It's amazing, and my whole team was out, in every school supporting the principals and making sure that, that anything that needed to be taken care of, we could assist with. But that being said, I had the opportunity to start at the George School, and a couple of things I'll share about that, and I'll have the team come up and talk to you about all the different levels. But I started out at the George School, lots of umbrellas, but lots of happy parents. I actually got a group of kids together. I was very pleased and took a picture with the group and did my first tweet today. So I am looking for people to follow me. So I am doing a Twitter account. I'm going to try to do each and every day something really good happening in the Brockton Public Schools to share with the public, because there's so much good happening. I think what was interesting is I went from the George, I ended up at West, I poked my head in at the high school, went over to the Kennedy a little later in the day, and will continue to do some visits as the week go on. The one thing that's interesting to watch is how quickly students acclimate to their setting. I don't care if they were the very littlest ones, and you're talking first graders, learning the routines, what recess is, what sharing is, you know, what the lunchroom is like, all of those different routines. But kids were learning. You know, I was in classrooms, you know, already they're reading, already they're doing icebreakers, they're getting to know their classmates, you know, talking about the school year. So I want to thank the teachers, our administrators, everybody for, you know, making the school day pretty much seamless. And, you know, in spite of the weather, in spite of so many things, they were ready to learn. I also will talk to you about, our teachers came back last Thursday, September 1st. I know a couple of you were able to attend. You know, thank you, Brett, you were there. Tom, thank you. It's always a big support as we welcome the teachers. I do want you to know that we publicly thanked you for all the work that you have done during this past budget season, during your kind of inaugural term. Many of you as school committee persons, very much appreciated by all of us and shared publicly with those there. It was an excellent opening, and I think when you think in terms of, you know, being down 30 positions, still looking at every classroom in the district to really see where we are and to have a handle, I can't compliment everybody enough, from our human resource office that is hiring teachers late term to get people into classrooms and to fill those much needed positions, to again, everybody in the district that pulls together when we certainly need people in the district to pull together. I also want to thank Lieutenant Mills, who was there to do a safety and security update while we had all of the teachers present in the auditorium for opening day. I think that what that does for us is, you had talked about making sure that everybody understands, you know, stay in place, lockdowns, all the terminology and things we've certainly gone over with our staff. Followed up here will be all of the drills. So Lieutenant Mills set the tone, went over all of these things with staff. He will follow up with drills at each site, and we'll continue to report to you on that. So I don't know if that answers your question about opening day, but I'd like to have, let me give you some of the numbers. So this year, our enrollment for opening day was 15,286. I'd like you to compare that to last year's 14,793. We continue again to defy what makes sense, as we think we're going to be losing students, and instead, as a large urban district, we're gaining students. Now, that being said, we do not have our kindergartners in yet. Our early numbers for kindergarten, presently we have 1,288 that are actually registered, placed, 140 already whose enrollments are still missing, you know, some type of a document, and I'd ask those parents to make sure they complete that so the kindergartners can start in a timely manner, which is September 15th. That being said, we know once we get school up and going, and our focus this week at the parent registration center are our students 1 through 12. We will then bring the focus back to kindergarten once we have kids in place this week going through some of those late arrivals that come. So we anticipate that we will surpass over 1,400 kindergarten students for this fall. So I do not think that we will see a decrease. And also, I can't thank enough Dr. DeBarros and her staff at the Parent Information Center. We had a line, and this was in the rain this morning, out down the side of the building. By the time I actually got over there, they certainly had things under control. Parents were being serviced. You know, folders were being completed. Kids were being placed in classes. And our goal is to get them in as quickly as possible, but making sure we have all those records. They saw just in the past 2 weeks, 334 new or returning students that they had to actually register for classes. So you can tell that is a very, very busy time for them. We have tried very hard to cap enrollment, as we talked about throughout the district. It is almost impossible to do that in different zones of the city. So when we talk about some of our priorities for this year, and we will be doing our school committee retreat very soon, you know, for the fall, to set goals for the superintendent, goals for us as a school committee, I do think we need to look at our zones. Our southwest zone, there isn't a seat to be had. Our northwest zone right now, we're looking at those numbers in our elementary grades. So as much as we think it's easy to do this, it implicates transportation. So we do have, and it is a policy in place that I think we need to take a deep look at, knowing where our numbers are right now, and preparing now before we go into registering, very soon after the first of the year for kindergarten, for those fifth graders going into sixth grade. So those are things that we will have to look at, and also looking at our facilities earlier rather than later for this year. I think these numbers impact that. We do have a meeting coming up, a Finance Committee meeting on the 13th of September. I still have a couple of priority positions. I'm looking at middle school and elementary, and I'd like to bring that to you. We're starting to identify possible funds as teachers, come off of, unemployment and either get jobs other places or have returned to Brockton. So at that point there, if we can identify some funds, I do have some priority positions that I'd like to bring to your attention at that time. So that being said, I'd like to invite some of the team members to come up and to share a little bit with you about opening day. Executive Director June Saber-McGuire and Dr. Cliff Murray, can you come up together and you can talk about middle and elementary school?
Good evening. So I'm so excited that I get to speak before Dr. Murray and before Sharon Walder, and I get to be the first one that says we had the best opening ever. So we did actually have a wonderful opening. I was able to start my day today at the Huntington School, so I got to go visit my alma mater, that's what I consider it, and walk around the building with Miss O'Brien, the new principal, and I do have to say I was a little bit upset with her because at one point she did introduce me to a first grade class as the old principal, and I straightened that out pretty quickly. I said, no, I'm the former principal, I am not the old principal. So it was really fun to walk around there and see really the energy and the enthusiasm in the school. It was really remarkable. Every single student in the school had their school uniforms on. You could tell that they were sitting there. They were very prideful. And again, the teachers were really just right back at it. When we say it sounds like a cliche that everybody was at work, everybody was at work. So, I mean, at 8:10 this morning, the students at the Huntington School were working, and breakfast in the classroom had already been served and already cleaned up. And that's the other really exciting thing to point out, that every single one of our elementary schools now has breakfast in the classroom. And by all accounts, I didn't get into every school, but I was in five of them today. It went tremendously well. And that's really a good feeling to think about our students starting the day with not one of them worrying about being hungry. The next school I went to was the Raymond School. Again, an exciting place for me to visit, knowing all the great work going on there. All of the students, 90% of the Raymond School students, I know you're interested in hearing how the uniform initiative is going. It was truly a sea of red at the Raymond School today. So again, same sort of feeling there. The atmosphere was just excellent. You could tell the students and the staff. One of the things that I was impressed with in every school I went to was how excited the teachers were to be back at school. And that, again, is despite some of the difficult circumstances at the elementary level and certainly middle and high school around staff, around student enrollment. I then went to the Baker, so I really did make the rounds today, and I was able to sit with Val Brower for a few minutes, and again, the same thing. She's just so excited. She's really hit the ground running, and what she said to me that was kind of fun was, well, I'm really enjoying being here, and one of the things that I realize is no matter what, a school is a school. Very excited to be there. So, I skipped the Brookfield. I did get to the Brookfield, too, and again, I walked around the building with Margot Masson, not a beat was skipped over there. So she really has taken the helm and she's running, I would say she had an excellent opening day. She was very excited. The students were a little bit sad about Mrs. Brower though, so I knew she was happy for me to share that with her when I went over to the Baker. And then finally I went to the Downey, and again I got to spend some time with Principal Kelly. He was very excited, and just it's almost like we didn't even close school. That's how quickly I think people have just gotten things up and running, and things are relatively, I would say, smooth. And then at the end of the day, I have to say, I know Liz Barry and I both got an email from Colleen Prowler, Principal Prowler over at the Arnon, and she was again excited, had said that in her 8 years as principal, this was the smoothest opening that she's ever had, and that her staff, her students, and her families really walked away feeling excited about the year to come.
How can I top that?
Good luck.
I mean, really? Well, let's see. The schools I visited today, Oh, one.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I'll come see you tomorrow.
I think the middle schools, I did talk to most of my colleagues today at one point, and I really would like to echo some of the comments that Ms. Saba had mentioned. They all felt like school hadn't stopped, hadn't changed, hadn't missed a beat. The buildings were in excellent shape. The guys in facilities this summer did a really nice job with repairs and things to fix up. They're clean. We had all the supplies we needed, thanks to Aldo. There was plenty of paper and that kind of stuff. We all got new printers, the wireless printers. So I think the teachers felt and the administration felt supported. The kids seemed very excited. And the rain, it's a little bit of a monkey wrench. It's kind of like when it snows. We had a lot of early arrivals in our buildings today, but the staff typically chips in and goes downstairs and chats with the parents. And we all kind of have the same plan where they meet in common areas, get their homeroom assignments, and then from there, their schedules. So it was really a pretty seamless day. No real concerns with transportation. It's a little slow the first day. You know, that's just a combination of things. But all in all, I think it was a very nice start. Some of the buildings are very full, and today was a very hot and very humid day. There was no tropical storm, just a humid heat wave. And so it was a little trying, a little tiring, but I think the kids enjoyed it. And I got, you know, great reports from everybody, so they were very happy.
Question. Mr. Sullivan.
Just one, Cliff. In the middle schools, did you get a look in the classrooms to see how many students are in a class?
Well, I can tell you there are three buildings that are very full, north, west, and the Pluff. Those classrooms typically have, you know, anywhere from 31 to 33 students in them. The building that I'm in, obviously, I spent a lot of time walking around today. It's very full. North is very full, and so is the Pluff. The Pluff had 709 students today.
Wow.
We're trying to catch up. We're about 20 behind. So they had a full house, and so did North. Some of the other buildings are still quite full. The class sizes are a little more reasonable, but you're still looking at 25, 26, depending on the level, you know, 27 students to a classroom. So the schools are full.
June, and the elementary the same?
The elementary are definitely the same, yes. Class sizes, I think, in fourth and fifth grade across the district are averaging 28, 29.
Wow.
Yeah.
That could even get worse with the child.
That could get worse. Well, not at the elementary level.
Oh, that's right. That's
right. But it could, because we don't have all of our students placed yet. So we're still waiting for more students to be placed in seats.
Anyone else? Ms. Plant, and then Mr. DiAgostino.
Now, we're very lucky that we have free lunch for all of our students, but has that caused any issues in the lunchroom?
Actually, I just commented to Mr. Petronio that without having to make change and students, you know, taking the money out of their pockets and that kind of stuff, it really sped the process up so that our students, especially with, you know, 260 students in the sixth grade lunch first day in the building, they went right through the line. It was very quick, which allowed them more time to socialize and to eat their lunch. So it was really kind of an added benefit that I don't think anybody really had given a lot of thought to. But it was very, it was significant, at least we noticed that in our building today.
Great, thank you.
That's a good point to bring up. I don't think we've had an opportunity on camera to let parents know. I know we've sent out a message that we have universal lunch throughout the district for every student. There are no lunch forms needed this year. The only cost would be for a la carte, or I think if there's a second lunch the student would want. Other than that, it is free lunch for every child in the Brockton Public Schools.
And how did that come about? Who decided to go after that as a grant? And
well, between Aldo Petronio and Tom Burke, you have to reach a certain percentage, mm-hmm. you know, to be considered. I think we put paperwork together, I want to say sometime in July. We kept waiting all summer because obviously you want to be prepared for the start of school and to let parents know to gear up as far as lunch forms go, which is a big operation. You know, previously, if you look at what happened, those lunch forms also made a difference in, which with our free and reduced, made a difference in our low income as far as our report for October 1st, our foundation budget, and actually monies, you know, for the Brockton Public Schools. So it was critical that we captured all of those students. With this, we were approved, I want to say it was last Wednesday or Thursday. I mean, you were talking, you know, the last minute, letting our families know. So it was approved finally by the state.
Well, I think
and we met the requirements.
I think all the school committee would like to thank whoever was, you know, responsible in terms of personnel that, you know, acted so quickly and efficiently, because I think it's a great benefit towards, you know, for many of our students, you know. So all involved, we, as a committee, thank you very much.
And I can't thank enough, when you talk about Tom Burke and the Chartwell staff, you know, Aldo Petronio, you know, what they do for kids. I mean, when you think about it, they're getting, you know, breakfast in the classroom at every elementary grade. Yeah, we have, of course, universal breakfast at the middle school. Dr. Murray and I were talking about that today, the kids that came in, you know, making sure they got the breakfast, free lunch throughout, you know, our entire district. And this comes with commitment. You know, Tom Burke, Chartwell's, they're always there for whatever we do and truly care. Although it is a business, it's always in the best interest of our children, and they are wonderful partners.
Are you all set, Ms. Plant? Mr. DiAgostino, I think you were next.
Yeah. And I know that the information that went out had, talking about the universal lunch, stated this, and I just don't recall. How many years has that been committed to?
Like, I think it's four.
It's 4 years?
4 years.
Okay, that's what I thought. Also, I was wondering, on the breakfast in the classroom, did we have some new schools that just started participating this year?
Actually, all of the elementary schools came on by the end of last year.
End of last year, okay.
Right.
All right, so this will be the first full year where everybody has that.
Yes.
And I have to say, you know, I think early on there were some mixed reviews mm-hmm. of that program, and last April I had a chance to sit down with Mr. Rogan over at the Kennedy, and we talked about that and you know, some of the pros and cons and things, the ways they had worked around some of the issues with it. But the big question that I asked him was, you know, what are the numbers? How many can, do you have numbers to show that this truly is benefiting kids and that more kids are getting, you know, to eat breakfast in the morning? And he did have them. And it was just, I don't remember what all the exact numbers were off the top of my head, but it was a huge difference. You know, it was kind of a no-brainer when he told me what the numbers were. So I'm glad to hear that we've got that in every elementary now.
Not only that, you have a nutritionist that's come on board the past 2 years with Chartwell's. And there were concerns. I went and spent time, I think I told you, last year at the George School with kids talking about nutrition. They saw a Pop-Tart, thought it was sugary. And really, that's not what the ingredients are. Mm-hmm. But to be able to talk to kids, to survey them, to find out what they want, and Chartwell's ended up sending teams in to actually go to, the, I think, the fifth grade at the George School to talk about those very options that we'd share throughout the district. I have to tell you, at the high school today, there are actually you know, TV screens with the menu rolling on the screen now, digital screens, and I wanted to run there and have lunch today. I mean, it looked great. I mean, the offerings look great. It shows you pictures. I'm not sure if the nutrition was there. I stood in front of them for a while, but just a great upgrade, and you know, makes you feel good about again, a company that is making sure it's all about the kids. So very pleased. And when you talk about the breakfast in the classroom, one of the things that we did do, and it has been such a success in Brockton, and you know they talk about Brockton all over the state, is we work very closely with our teachers, we work closely with the custodians, we had planning time built in, you know, with staff to do a dry run, to see what would work, to make sure we ironed out every little problem from the straw with the little kids getting put into the juice boxes and spilling all over the place, you know, before the start of school. So all of those things, certainly Chartwell's has had an open ear. They've worked very, you know, closely with us and with the schools. And again, that's the reason for all your successes when you come together as a team to make this happen.
Anyone else? How did transportation go from your perspectives? Any issues that you heard about? Or?
I didn't get any.
I think it's the typical, everything's a little delayed.
Yeah.
The students aren't used to getting on the bus on time, but we didn't have any major complaints or problems at all.
Deputy Superintendent Torrance,
the help police officers were available in some of the higher volume areas, so that's very, very helpful, because typically people are a little nervous the first day. You'll have more people dropped off at school. So it was very helpful to have the additional officers.
Especially because it was raining. Everybody drove their children to school today.
And with that, another thank you to our school police, to our crossing guards. They were out in force. I was at the George School, which has been known to be very difficult, you know, in terms of lot. It was seamless. I mean, you waited in a little bit of a line while people dropped the kids off and moved on, but absolutely seamless at that school. So I want to thank everybody that was out in force today.
Mrs. Minnie dropped off Greg, and she said that it went pretty, I mean, for a day that she said was rainy, she thought it went pretty well, you know, nothing unexpected, so to speak. So that's good. So didn't get much information from my son about how his day went, though.
Just call Ms. Zachary. She'll fill you in.
Yeah, right. Brutal. These boys are brutal. They don't offer up much at all, I'm telling you.
Count your blessings.
anyone else for Ms. Sable McGuire or Mr. Murray? Ms. Azak.
I actually had a chance, and I stopped this morning over at the Asheville School, and I stopped over at the Brookfield, and everyone was pretty much excited. Everything was going in accordance with, everyone was just following the principals. I didn't get a chance to stay that long at the Asheville, but the Brookfield, I was there for a little bit, so it was exciting to finally see all these, you know, young ones already and excited to start their 2016-2017 school year. So looking forward to seeing what else this year has for them, I guess. But
great. We good?
We're good.
Thank you both.
Thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Okay. Can I have Principal Sharon Wolder come up and talk to us about Brockton High School? And Dr. Tarasi can join her also to talk to us about the alternative schools, the alternative pathways. They all had shirts on today.
Uh-huh.
Great team building with those shirts, Principal Wolder. I love them.
Well, thank you. Unfortunately, we had about 95% of our faculty wearing them, so that was nice to set a tone for Brockton High School. As you know, we had several things to navigate and a short amount of time to get it together. So let me just put it to you this way. It was an incredibly successful opening, Miss June Saber McGuire. We got scholarship up and running, and as you know, just seems like a couple weeks ago, I was here before you saying this is what we needed in order to get our students into the school and to account for their attendance. And so it took a lot of work to get all of the drops in, so facilities was great in helping to make sure that happened. The scholarship company, we had a few back and forth with them, and they got everything in, came in last week, got the deans and assistant deans and the floor teachers trained in how to use the scholarship system. We invited students to come in for freshman orientation last week to give them their IDs and had the upperclassmen come that afternoon to pick up IDs. Fortunately, probably about two-thirds of the students came in early to get them so they could come right in this morning without an issue. And so for the rest of the students, they received them today as they were coming into the school. So we were able to give out IDs, give out schedules. A lot of the students accessed their schedules on the student portal, which was another change from this summer. So we put that information out on the new website. Students were able to find it, access their schedules that way. A number of them were walking around with their handheld devices, looking at their schedules as they were finding their way around the school. So having access to that was good for them. And it helped us move things along quite a bit this morning. We had no homeroom, as you know, because that's part of the new schedule, and so we were a bit concerned about how that would impact us, having so many kids come in. We normally would have held up the bells and just held them until we had everybody in where they needed to be and move things forward. We didn't have that opportunity to run things that way, so we ran our schedule, and we figured we'd start them out with the schedule we have and get them used to it right away. And so we ran with it, and things ran smoothly. We were able to get the students in, get them accounted for. It was a challenge balancing infinite campus data along with scholarship data because we're still in that transitional phase. But we worked with Deb Leach, and she was very helpful in making sure we had what we needed for the attendance piece of it. So that all went well. The six periods, we got through them before I knew it, the day was over. And lunches went well. I did have one very happy parent who brought her child's lunch and said, I don't ever have to do this again. And I said, not for 4 years. So she walked out very happy. And when we have lunches at the high school, it's always a challenge to see how the first day is going to go. Things ran very smoothly. And those monitors helped because kids tend to get in the wrong line, and then by the time they get up to it's their turn, they realize this is not the line they want to be in. So those monitors really supported making sure visually kids could figure out where they were supposed to be. So that was also helpful. At the end of the day, we did have to navigate some bus issues, and we've already talked to Mr. Thomas and Lieutenant Mills about moving one of the bus areas so that we can get more buses in and around the school the way we need to at the end of the day to make dismissal a little smoother. So all in all, an incredibly successful day.
Questions or comments? Ms. Plant.
I'd just like to say that I'm the mother of a high schooler who's a girl, and they usually have plenty to say.
Yeah.
And with all the changes that you had this year, she really, no, everything was just as usual. And she got to go and get her stuff early, and I think that made a big difference. And she had her schedule, and she showed it to me on her smartphone before school even began. So I think you really did a great job in kind of streamlining that. And you had a lot to deal with this year. And from her perspective, it went very smoothly.
Well,
so good job.
Thank you, and I'm glad to hear that. From the student side, they thought it was a good day, too.
How did you find the entry of students in terms of the speed now with scholarship, you know, checking in?
What we know is that it will get faster. For students, it was something new, so of course they're standing there trying to figure out exactly what do they do, and once they got going with it, it was fine. And so now it'll be a matter of, fortunately, the kiosks allow two students to come in at a time, and now that they know what they're doing, it'll move them in much faster. The side where we had kids who did not have the IDs, that piece of it obviously was going to take a little longer. But moving the kids through, it actually went very well.
So how many entrances and where are they that you utilize in the
The entrances, there are two doors in each house. They're the side doors of the buildings.
Okay.
And we have a kiosk in each of those entrances so that students can come in those two side doors. We also had a kiosk at the main office that we did not utilize because the students do come in through the sides. But we do have a population of students who we will use that kiosk to have them come through. So our students who are severe special needs, we are going to make sure that they have access to use the same system as other students.
Mm-hmm.
And so they will be using that kiosk.
So if a student comes in a little late, what do they do? What is the procedure?
The procedure is great, actually, because the kiosk actually it prints an ID for them that says that they're late. So instead of the old-fashioned way where they would come in, somebody would sign them in on the computer and then write out a pass for them, actually when they scan, the kiosk will print a tardy pass for them so they can go straight to class.
So they don't come in the main office, they come in the side doors?
They come in
really?
The side doors.
Yeah, I was curious about that. Anyone else want to follow up? Mr. Sullivan.
I'd just like to congratulate you and your staff, Principal Walter. You did a fabulous job. I know with the no homeroom on the first period was confusing for a lot of people, but you made it. You went through it. You and your staff did one heck of a job. Thank you.
And thank you. It was a great team effort by everyone at the school. So it felt like a team, and the shirts weren't just shirts. It really is what we are living. That boxer pride is really what we wanted to see all of our faculty embody and demonstrate it for our students. And we had 130 sophomores, juniors, and seniors who were trained as mentors who were there all day helping the freshmen navigate the building. So we had a student team who was there just doing everything that they could to help the new students figure out their way around the school, sit with them at lunchtime, help them find the bus, help them find their classes. So they were an incredible part of our team as well. Thank you.
And Mr. Gormley.
I shared with Ms. Walder earlier that my daughter got lost today, and I don't know if it was a member of the team, but if it wasn't, it would be great that my daughter was helped by an upperclassman who noticed that she was lost. So I'm going to check with her and see if it was, but if it wasn't, I think that's pretty awesome that you have so many kids, and I think it's bleeding over into the rest of the student body to be helpful, because I know when I was here, I probably would have told them to go to the purple building.
I remember seeing students years ago who would ask, where's the fourth floor? Where's the purple building? It's like, those things don't exist. We were at 92% as we balanced the two different versions of attendance. It looked like about 92% attendance. The 4,214 students. We are setting up schedules for another 75 today or tomorrow, and this evening actually they were doing some scheduling, and tomorrow. So we have a number of students who are enrolling now. We'll be there.
And how did you and the staff find the additional period today?
I was so busy, I didn't notice it, to be honest with you. I'm sure they did in a different way because they're teaching, but it was just, people were where they needed to be, and the class sizes were what we were hoping for. They were decent. So thank you so much for that. We do have some things we have to work out because we still have some students with two DAs, and we have a number of students in directed academics the last two periods of the day, so we're going to have to do some work there to try to balance those things out. But for the most part, teachers got through the day positive, helping kids, excited, and because we didn't shorten the periods, they actually had a good amount of time with each of their classes to really do some ice-breaking things and getting to know them. So I think it was a positive experience as well. Exhausting for all of us, but positive, absolutely.
Well, we thank you.
As the year goes on, I have asked Principal Walder to come before you, as we do every year, to really talk about, the goals at Brockton High School, to talk about some of the challenges, ahead of time, and to also, talk about the excitement of teachers, teaching, new classes and new opportunities for our students. And also to see, some of the things that we do need a little bit of time to fix. But I also want to thank you because we all know how difficult this summer was. And coming together and looking at data and, certainly trusting the team. And they put in a lot of hard work the month of August. So, again, I want to thank you. I know a lot of work went into that, from all levels of your administration, your teachers, parents. So we're very pleased.
Thank you.
Great. All set for Principal Walder? Okay, thank you so much. Dr. Taurasi.
Okay, there isn't much that I can add to all of the wonderful things that have been said, but I did visit a few of the alternative programs today, and they all had a very, very smooth start. First, I went to the Goddard. We have about 50 students enrolled at the Goddard. Attendance was about 90% and a very smooth opening. The few students that were not able to be there, that was because there were several students that were hospitalized over the summer, and they will eventually be transitioned into school. Made my way over to the Keith complex, the Keith building, and good start at the Champion School, about 85% attendance there. We had, you should know that we had some difficulty with our Infinite Campus system. One of the servers in the IT department went down over the weekend, and believe it or not, you had a lot of staff people in various schools working right over the Labor Day weekend, Saturday, Sunday, and into Monday. That server didn't come back online until Monday about 12 noon, so there was a lot of sort of last-minute scheduling that needed to be done. I know people at the high school were working on that, people at the Davis, people at the Keith building. So all in all, given those adversities, things were very smooth. And as you know, in the Keith Complex, we have not only the Champion, but the Frederick Douglass Academy opened. They opened with an enrollment of 51 students. 12 of those students don't begin yet because they're going to begin in the Champion City program, which is a Chapter 222 program. They won't begin for another few days. So, you know, making the correction for their not being there, there was about an 85% attendance rate, making an adjustment for them. Pathways program opened with a number of students already enrolled. And of course, they will be recruiting students from the dropout list as we go through the first few weeks of school. We have a program that has moved from Brockton High School, which is the life skills program, postgraduate life skills program. And the teacher and all of those students were actively engaged. Two of the EI programs were sent out of the Keith building. One is located at Brockton High, one remained in the Keith building, and those students were all sort of present and accounted for. So, you know, all in all, with all the changes that were made over the summer, it was a remarkably successful opening. No major transportation problems, and things are looking good.
Mr. D'Agostino.
Just overall, at every level, I'm just very impressed with how successful the day was. There were challenges at every school. I mean, we had over 15,000 kids start today in buildings all over the district, and you know, it was a success everywhere from the sound of it, and that doesn't happen without a fully committed team across the district as well, and we clearly have that. And so I think I just wanted to again thank everybody who was a part of that in every building. Is that number of kids starting on the same day won't be successful if you don't have the right committed team in place to do that.
Well, when we talk about the alternative settings, one of the things that we'll be sharing with you is as we watch grants again dry up, you know, and this is statewide, you know, nationwide, you know, we're going to continue to look for, we lost a youth at-risk grant. Many of these, you know, support these alternative pathways for our students. So that is one of our major goals this year, is continuing, you know, to look for those grants to really support what has been successful programming for many of our students.
I would agree with Mr. D'Agostino. I'm very pleased, but I'm really not surprised. I think we have, you know, some of the finest staff and teachers and, you know, administrators at all levels. And Brockton, you know, although, you know, things happen once in a while, for a system as large as this system, it runs extremely efficient because of the people that we have. And, you know, we have wonderful teachers that are good mentors to the younger teachers and good examples. So, you know, it's overall a system that has a reputation statewide, and there's a reason for that reputation. And we're very fortunate in the city to be blessed with such a, you know, wonderful school system that, you know, prepares our students to go on. I've heard story after story about kids, you know, in school and college now that are doing extremely well, and the reason why is because of all the attention from teachers at all of their levels, elementary, middle, and high school. And you know, the proof is in the pudding. If you know, if they're successful in college, you know that the foundation they received here in Brockton, you know, is wonderful, and that's basically what we have. You know, our kids are successful when they go on to college. And there's a reason for that. So we're very fortunate. Dr. Taurasi, the life skills program, can you tell us a little bit about it? What ages and what exactly? I'm very interested.
This is called the postgraduate life skills program, because students with disabilities are entitled to services until the age of 22.
Yeah.
So sometimes they've met all of their requirements of their IEP, but we continue to provide them with services. And that's a program that had been at Brockton High School for many years. And because Brockton High School agreed to inherit some of the programs that we wanted to send over from the Keith, there was sort of an exchange. And now there are, I think, two EI classes at the high school. And we took the postgrad. But they do a lot of sort of community involvement work, life skills, kind of life adjustment. life adjustment type work, and very successful program. They're sort of, they're based out of the Keith, but they're you know, out in the community also.
About how many students did you mention that?
There were 12 students in class today.
Okay.
And that was in one class, and I didn't go into the other class, so I didn't get a head count for that.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Sullivan.
My name is Sharon Walder, Dr. Torres. I just wanted to congratulate you for a job well done. And I kind of had a question about the people who worked to get that computer up and running on the holiday and Saturday. Is there any letter of commendation that can go into the file for that?
We certainly can, yeah. Dan Vigen and his staff came in. They thought they could do it remotely. I think it was kind of rebooting the system.
Right.
When we realized there was a problem, I believe the system locked down, so we were not able to reboot it remotely, and Rick came in and actually worked, I want to say,
came
yesterday.
In
it was cleared up probably about 12:30, 1 o'clock.
Yeah, by 12 o'clock it was up and running, but that was on Monday. And, you know, I happened to be on the phone with the director of that department, Dan Vigent, and his comment to me was, I said, gee, you know, thanks very much, Danny, for having somebody go in and taking care of that, and I'm, you know, kind of complimenting him. And his response to me was, that just comes with the territory, no problem.
Wow.
Just, you know.
Just that we're so quick to put a negative comment in their files, why not get something nice in there?
We will take care of that, Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll record your remarks for next year and hit the button.
And last but not least, I'd like to bring up the two deputies. They'll update you as far as operations, transportation, which is Deputy Superintendent Thomas. Deputy Superintendent Barry will talk to you about the charter and what plans we put in place there, and also the Parent Registration Center. She headed up our plans knowing that we possibly could have students returning. I will address that situation, but we will tell you what was put in place and how that transpired.
Good evening, thank you. So 50 buses from First Student and 53 vans went around the city today, along with 36 added vans that some are in the city, some are outside the city. The 36 are for wheelchair transportation, homeless transportation, either out of the city or into the city, and some other special ed transportation that are out of district. But the yellow vans and buses that you see around for a student, that's the majority of our students. That's about 8,500 students that are bused in vans across the city. And as always, it's not always a smooth start with transportation with that many kids are running from across the city with the rain, with a lot of people driving their kids to school on the first day, and also you know, people not knowing the bus stops, not knowing what time to be there. So a lot of things get delayed on the first day. Overall, the way I see it as a success is that all kids made it to school that were supposed to come to school on a bus and van, and all kids made it home at the end of the day that were supposed to go home on a bus or a van. So that alone is a success. It always, with a three-tiered busing system, as you know, when you run buses the first tier, if that tier runs late, then you end up late on the second and third tier. So the high school traffic was very busy this morning, if anybody was around the high school this morning. So you had a lot of people driving kids to school, and it's just, again, the first day, kids not knowing where they're going when they get off the bus. So it does delay things, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes, and when the first tier is delayed, then everything else gets delayed behind it. But again, overall, it ran pretty well. SchoolBot, there's about 20, that's our online app where parents can see where their bus is. It's Where's My Bus is the name of it. We have about 15 buses that are still not uploaded into that system. First Student did upgrade some of their buses. They try to do that every year. So they ended up with about 15 newer buses. So now that GPS has to be uploaded into the SchoolBot system, so then parents can identify that on their app. So overall, I think the buses ran pretty well, but again, there's always a delay, and that's usually pretty much the case for the first 3 days of school. By next Monday, we'll be running pretty well. but then it gets bogged down a bit again when kindergarten starts on the 15th, and it starts over again because things get delayed because, you know, the bus will pause so people can take pictures of their new ones going to school, and so that kind of delays things as well. So, but all that's good. So, again, once things get rolling and everybody understands the bus they're supposed to be on and the vans, we figure, you know, it goes pretty well. And also there's a lot of construction across the city. You have construction on West Elm and a lot of other places that are under construction. So there's a lot of detours, and that again, that's tough for a bus to go different ways than they're used to and not as direct. So that causes some delays as well. So before I can go into facilities, I can answer any questions on the buses or concerns you might have.
With the last minute change on the charter school not opening in Brockton, how did that affect our transportation? Was it helpful, or did it kind of throw everything because it was so last minute?
It threw a lot off at East Middle School. A lot of the kids that are coming back from the charter school are being placed at East because there's room at East now. So we had it, again, we put three buses aside in Tier 2. We're using those three buses, obviously, for our own Brockton Public Schools kids. One of those buses now is going to East Junior High, so they'll go from three buses to four. So that caused a lot of confusion at East. Kids not knowing if they're on the bus or not on the bus, having to make a new bus list, having to make a new routes for that bus, and that was just being done today. So that's a lot to put on the Parent Information Center, not only when you're taking thousands of calls about where is the bus and why is it late, and a lot of calls about, you know, some of the transportation, the van transportation. Now you're basically creating a new bus list that has probably 15 stops on it now to service a school that, you know, we weren't expecting to do last Friday. So,
and you're going to have to redo it all over again in January.
Correct. Yep. So it's not an easy situation, and that's something that we'll have to discuss as we go forward, as we get more information about the charter school and how many, as we figure out as the dust settles and see actually how many kids are actually back with us. And I know the superintendent has those numbers. But at this time, again, it did create a problem for East Middle School, no question about it.
The Where's My Bus app. I know you can download that from any of the app stores, but beyond that, if you know, a parent needed help getting that set up and configured properly, is there, who would they be able to call about?
They could. There's online help.
Okay.
Or they also can call the transportation office, and they could call that number, and they can walk them through as well.
Awesome. Thank you.
No problem.
Want to move on to the next topic?
Sure. Facilities. We didn't do any major projects this year, like as we have done in the past when we renovated the Davis modulars, or the year before when we redid the Barrett-Russell, and last year we did the Kennedy modulars. So this year we did a lot of small projects, but we were able to do a lot in a lot of different schools. So we replaced a lot of ceilings throughout the district. At the Hancock, we did the cafeteria and the main hallway. We did that. We did some ceiling work at the Brookfield. We also did some ceiling work at East. We were able to put the extra air conditioners in the cafeterias across the district in schools that do not have air conditioning. We were able to do that in the libraries as well, just so these schools have some large areas when it gets really hot that they can send the kids, especially like something like this Friday when it's going to be in the 90s. At least there's a couple of spots in these buildings that are hot, you know, the second floor of West, second floor of East, those old junior highs, that's hot. It gets hot up there. So it's nice for them to have spots to send these kids when it gets into the high 80s and 90s. We were able to do a lot of floors, carpets. We were able to get, the goal is to get rid of as much carpet as old carpet as we can across the district, and replace with tile. It's cleaner, it's healthier, and you don't have the tripping hazards that the old carpet causes. So we're moving towards that. We're able to get a lot of floors done. We've been doing that at the high school now for the last almost 3 years. There's been so many rooms here at the high school to replace, so we're pecking away at that. We're probably 60% done with the high school carpet and all the rooms, but we have a ways to go. I don't know if you noticed at the high school, we were able to do the apron, which is the lower part of the brick. We were able to do some repairs with our masons and paint that. It looks a lot better, plus it's also helping with some water issues. We were able to replace a lot of old exterior doors throughout the buildings. We did some at West, at the Keith, some real high profile doors that have just old that needed to be changed out and obviously make the school much, much more safe. And we were able to do some more exterior cameras. We were able to do exterior cameras at the Plouf, the Angelo, and the Unknown to get some more, a better coverage of outside the building and out into the streets. And again, that helps keep the school safe. And as the school department and the city have been working over the last 2 years to bring our cameras to a central location, so they all now go to the police department. It's a central located server, and they all feed back to the police department, all of our cameras now. That's been put in place over the last 2 years, and that's a major accomplishment. It makes things a lot safer. What else? And that's in Brockton High, something that you don't see, we were able to do the electrical switch gear in one of the penthouses over the red, which is a major job. It's probably a $100,000 job that we do for about half because we do it in-house, and that's stuff that I really can't explain to you. All it does is basically where all the electrical comes into the building, that's the switch gear it comes into, and it does help us overcome a lot of problems with the age of the old switch gear. So that's work that is much needed and something that no one sees, but it's something that makes a big difference. And again, I want to thank the school police. As you know, they're shorthanded, but Lieutenant Mills was able to disperse the officers that he has to as many schools as possible. And if the schools did not see an officer in the morning arrival, they saw them at dismissal. And then he does a nice job of rotating them around. So they're in the buildings throughout the day, but they also try to help with arrival and dismissal at all buildings. And as you know, from anybody that drives by a school, there's always issues with arrival and dismissal. There's just really no way around it. Just try to make it as smooth as possible.
Mr. Sullivan.
Yes, I would like to commend you as well, Mr. Thomas. Number one, the buses today. You mentioned the detours and the road construction, Main Street, West Elm Street. They seem to be all over the place. And the traffic was just unbelievable. But somehow these buses all got through. I hit them a little late, but they were there. It was a job well done. And the other, on these, the facilities, I know the capital money was cut this year quite a bit, but you managed somehow to get everything done. And that itself is a job well done. Thank you.
Oh, thanks. Ken Thompson and Jamie Domestico in the facilities department, they really work hard. They put a lot of time in, and the guys, the craftsmen and the custodians, they take a lot of pride in their work, so, and it shows. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
You should be very impressed, because as we know, Mr. Sullivan is an expert in transportation. So to compliment you on transportation, that's coming from a veteran over here. So, you know, it goes a long way, Mr. Thomas.
Thank you.
But you do tell him that you and I discussed toughing it out during our days at East on the second floor.
Yes.
And so did Mr. Thomas. He toughed it out at East as well.
Yep.
You know, but, oh well, any improvements are welcome.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas, speaking of East, I heard over the weekend that there was a power outage.
Yes, we had, there were some tree limbs hanging on one of the power lines. Mm-hmm. So I received a call from the assistant principal who was there doing some work. Half the building lost power. Yeah. So then I called Ken, who was able to call the public property, because our electricians were on vacation and not around, so Jimmy Burgess came in to help Ken. National Grid came out right away, trimmed the trees. They were on a neighbor's yard. I guess Ken went over and the lady was nice enough to give us permission to trim the trees off the line. So once that was taken care of, National Grid could get the power back on. So
wonderful. Well, compliments to Public Properties and Mr. Burgess and your staff who obviously took care of it, because that was one of our concerns, basically the storm and the wind. Yeah. And you know, as we remember from the year before, we had to make up a day on one of the schools because we had to call it due to an electrical. Wasn't it East?
It was about 6 years ago at East and then 3 years ago at the Kennedy.
Kennedy, right. Yeah. Both and that cost quite a bit of money for the one day to bring the staff in.
We couldn't get a waiver for that.
You know, somehow the charter schools get waivers, but the public schools don't get that same extension of goodwill. I don't understand it, but we'll have to ask Mr. Chester when he's here in a week or so.
And I apologize, Mr. Minicello outed me, superintendent. The superintendent did not know about East. I was no reason to worry her.
So. Allow me to assist.
But it was all taken care of by about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, so there was no need to bother the superintendent about.
I'll put a letter in his file.
Any more questions for Mr. Thomas? Mr. DeAgostino.
Just a compliment to the facilities team. As you know, I had brought a few issues over to Kennedy to your attention, and actually one of them had to be addressed by DPW, and you got right on top of it, and the folks at facilities got on top of what they could do, and DPW got out there when they could. And, so everybody does a great job on with that, and I mean, we've got so many old buildings that have, I can't imagine how many maintenance concerns there are coming at the facility staff. So they really do a great job, but I appreciate the quick response to the concerns I had brought to you before.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Great, anyone else? Thank you very much.
And last but not least, we're gonna talk a little bit about the Parent Information Center and the charter. I'll invite Deputy Superintendent Barry to come up and share with you the plans we put in place, but let me go back to what has happened. I think all of you are aware, and a couple of things I want to make clear. We have been speaking to parents, we'll talk to you about our plans, but I do want to make it clear that the charter school is not a part of the Brockton Public Schools. It is totally a separate district, a charter school district, although we have opened lines of communication because I've made it very clear that once this charter was approved, we have worked to make sure that the children that or families that chose the charter, that it was the priority that these children would get the education that they were promised and that they deserved. I'm very concerned about what's happening. I have been in touch with the DESE Office of Charter Development, sharing our concerns and speaking with them almost on a daily basis. We'll continue to do that as this week unfolds, but it has been lots of hard work on this district as we try to get set for, as we know, over 17,000 of our own students in the district and having to put some plans in place the past couple of days. So, Deputy Superintendent.
So as Superintendent Smith alluded to, as we learned of the increasing challenges that New Heights was having in regards to location and start date, et cetera, we became concerned that a lot of our students, our former students, would hop on a bus and show up at their former middle school with the idea that they could then just sort of become part of that community. We had some unique plans this morning. We usually, at least the Office of Learning and Teaching, gets to every elementary and every middle school. But rather than doing that, we had folks from the Office of Learning and Teaching, as well as executive team members, report first thing in the morning at our middle schools in preparation for students who are New Heights students who, for one reason or another, arrived on our very doorsteps. So we weren't sure how many kids to expect, and we just know it is an extremely busy day for building-based leadership teams, and this is, again, an added layer that we really wanted to help them out with. So we had a script that we utilized in calling parents when New Heights students arrived at each one of these schools. In many cases, parents felt that they
didn't necessarily understand enrollment. As Superintendent Smith said, some of them thought that it was one of the Brockton Public Schools. There was just a lot of misunderstanding. So we actually had 16 students across the district arrive at one of our middle schools, and also including the Davis K-8, who thought that they could become part of the Brockton Public Schools today. And it was difficult because we had to get in touch with parents and basically say, these students were not were unenrolled in the Brockton Public Schools and therefore needed to go through a process of re-enrollment. So the Parent Information Center is an extremely busy place. And we had to send those students back with their parents back to the school registration center so that they could, in fact, re-enroll in one of our Brockton Public Schools. And as Dr. Murray said, there are some schools where we're worried about enrollment, and we have capped at certain grade levels. So some of these kids, you know, they run the risk of losing their seat in the school that maybe they had spent sixth and seventh grade in. And so it was tough. It was just a tough day all around for that. So we did have 16, again, show up at our schools, and we worked with their parents to redirect them to the school registration center. Part of the script, just in the interest of full disclosure, if we were to contact parents and they would say, oh no, you know, I want to continue at New Heights, we had a whole script for, if you want to continue, here's what you need to know. Here's what you need to know about the plan in place over the next couple of days, because we were concerned that for whatever reason they weren't getting the information. So if they did opt for New Heights, we were able to give them additional information so that we weren't swaying them one way or the other. Last week, we had 23 students come out of New Heights, 23 Brockton students, and actually come back into the Brockton Public Schools, and we had 26 today. So of the 16 that showed up in our schools today, they were actually part of the 26. So those are our former students who enrolled at New Heights who are now coming back to us. And just, you know, talking about the school registration center, Mr. Thomas and I were there this afternoon, I think it was like 3:30. You have to walk by the line that's going out the door, and they had already seen 215 families today. They said that through the month of August, they had seen 2,444 families because of registration and other issues. So we're talking about an extremely busy office, and having to send people back to school registration in order to re-enroll is just tough because we know how busy that office is already. So, you know, that was how we spent our day. And, you know, I'll tell you that a lot of these kids were sad because I think they thought they could just stay for the whole day, and in some cases perhaps that worked, but we went through a very prescribed process in unenrolling kids, and we actually worked with New Heights to define what that process looked like. They wanted the same process on the other end, and we wanted to be able to honor it. So we had to have families go back to school registration center and go through the process of re-enrollment today. Just a couple of other things that I think we mentioned earlier, but just some of the things that may come your way. Superintendent Smith talked about K registration. If you hear from anybody regarding K registration, what we do is we suspend kindergarten registration until September 12th, and we do that because school has already started for all of the other grade levels. If a family goes to school registration and they have a kindergartner, someone from school registration won't send them away, but what they do instead is they actually talk to families about the pre-registration process. They show them how to register online, and they also make appointments for the families to come back. If that kindergarten student has a sibling in one of the other grade levels, that child, the kindergarten child, will be enrolled along with his or her siblings as well. But just in case that comes your way and you're wondering why, we pull back on kindergarten because we prioritize the other grade levels so that kids aren't missing school. A couple of other things regarding open houses. Open houses at the elementary level take place this week, and then the following weeks at the high school and the alternatives. And we actually have the open houses posted on our beautiful website. So.
Anyone who is embarrassed?
Ms. Plant.
I have a question. It seems that with the switching of the charter, opening a new location in January, it's really put an unfair burden on our district. Mm-hmm. And is it costing us?
You know, I think we could probably think about it that way. And I would also say an unfair burden on families. I felt awful talking to some of these families who had to leave work and pick their kids up. And it just was an unexpected set of circumstances today. Is it costing us? Perhaps it is. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, I would agree with Ms. Barry, Mrs. Barry, that this is costing mm-hmm. us. It's costing us time and energy away from, you know, the needs of the district. You know, the question that was asked when the process was taking place was, where are you siting the school? What are you offering these kids? You know, where's the location? And as far as I'm concerned, the state was grossly negligent in that, in the process, this important piece, location, 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 facility, was never answered. And as we all see in the paper, and I'm quoted as a debacle, I stand by that. This has been a debacle. Would they have ever approved New Heights then, knowing what they know now, that you're going to send Randolph, Taunton, Brockton kids to Norwood? Well, they're doing that, to me, inappropriately. They should have basically said, well, guess what? You're not ready. So therefore, we're not approving this. But of course they did. It's just, I'm amazed by this. But like Ms. Barry said, we have students to take care of, and we will welcome these kids with open arms. Brockton always does that, and we will take care of these kids that come back to our doorstep, because that's what we do in Brockton, and that's what we will always do. But, you know, energy, time, and money is being wasted at all levels with regard to this decision to go forward with this situation. I stand by that. The facts are the facts. Mr. DeAgostino.
Relating to the charter and everything that's going on around it, first I want to start by just commending the entire team in Brockton Public Schools at all levels for everything that they have done to try to make it as seamless as they can and to put the kids first. The folks at DESE, including the commissioner, I feel are charged with the same responsibility we are of doing what's in the best interest of the kids, in our case Brockton, and in their case across the state. I can't for the life of me understand how the commissioner or anybody else at DESE can think that allowing this, and I think that's the perfect word, Mr. Minicello, this debacle to continue was in any way in the best interest of the students in Brockton. How he could ever think that that is in the best interest of the students in Brockton and that that is putting the students of our city first. I don't understand how it's remotely possible to begin to think that way. But I do want to commend, you know, our Brockton Public Schools team for everything that they have done to do their part in, I was going to say, making it less of a debacle, but I don't know that there's anything we can do, you know, that's kind of out of our hands. But to make it as smooth as you possibly can, given what is happening for the kids. But I just don't understand where the commissioner is coming from on this.
And interesting enough, Mr. DeAgostino, I believe the day that the two deputies met with the charter team to have discussions about the challenges they were facing, mm-hmm. I was on the telephone with Dr. Cancel, with Alyssa Hopkins, you know, out of the DESE. And if I didn't hear it once, twice, I want to tell you we heard it five times. And quite honestly, I didn't want to hear it anymore. But what they talked about was the professionalism of our staff coming together to talk to them about how you put transcripts together. You know, our staff coming together to work with transportation to make sure that these kids could be transported safely. Special education discussions about some concerns we had for some special ed students, severely special needs, that we had concern about being able to be serviced. So while the DESE was very complimentary in the way that our district operates and will always operate, we again had follow-up conversation, as I told you, as late as Friday with Alyssa Hopkins. I will be in close conversation with her, you know, to take a look at what these numbers are. So in other words, we stand behind our 229 of those students that we had received so-called transfers into the charter. And it looks to me like that number has dropped certainly below 200. So it's going to be interesting, you know, is this, again, I'll say it, are these people clamoring for a charter? Are these 600 parents rushing, you know, for the doors? You know, we were sold a bill of goods that were not true back in the springtime when this charter was given. And we will, again, and it's not about kids here, kids come first. But that being said, we as a district will be looking legally, you know, looking at, you know, quite honestly, you mentioned a cost. We're not sure what those costs are, other than it certainly has taken us away from our mission and the students that, you know, are, you know, entering the Brockton Public Schools. So as I said, this is in good faith. That's the only way that we operate. And we'll continue to put the kids first. But I do want you to know we will be looking at talking to the DESC and really questioning this oversight.
Yeah, I mean, the management team at that school, I mean, talk about dropping the ball at every opportunity. I can't think of any point at which the management over there has got it right. Maybe I didn't see it, but so far, which just adds to, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to go on about this, but it's really just, I know it's bothering everybody, but how they can continually to watch this horrible management and continue to waive requirements and grant them this exception, and I aren't they about to have their fourth lottery?
I believe there was another lottery. One of the things that they said that I think it's important for the public to hear is on Friday when I spoke to Alyssa Hopkins, if there are concerns, because we've also been dealing with parents all day long, and this started back last Thursday, last Friday, continued into today. If there are concerns by parents for whatever reason, they can contact the commissioner's office and the DESC or the Board of Trustees of the charter school. And that's been instruction given to us by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education.
Great.
Can we put that information on our Brockton Public School site?
We can certainly talk about, you know, how we do that. And I will have the conversation with Alyssa Hopkins, you know, to make sure that, again, we are dealing with parents. We're trying to deal with the parent that's frustrated, the parent that didn't understand they weren't a part of the Brockton Public Schools when they took the child out of the PLUF to go for this wonderful new opportunity and then realized they didn't want their child leaving Brockton and had no knowledge that this was not a Brockton Public School. That to me is something that we again need to make clear, and I will have those conversations with the department.
Mr. Sullivan.
Yes, Superintendent, Deputy Superintendent Barry. Somebody mentioned the cost. I'm not sure who did, but I know there was a cost because I was at Central last week for a couple of meetings late at night, and the parent registration center was open. They said it was open until 7 o'clock that night, so there has to be a cost on it. And then today, going by, I see the line outside in the pouring rain. You know, there had to be 20, 25 people. My question to you was, you may not be able to answer it, but if these students are transferring back from the charter school to Brockton Public Schools, when that school opens up, are they going to transfer back again? Or do you know?
You know, I can only speak to the conversations that I've had personally today, and I would say that these parents wanted nothing more than a seat back in the school that their kids were at before. Lots of conversation about them losing faith or misunderstanding a process. So I can't say what most parents would do, but I believe what you're talking about is, in most cases, at least for this group of 16, families that originally misunderstood, and families that want nothing more than to just come back to Brockton.
Nice.
Anyone else for Mrs. Barry? Thank you very much. It might not be a bad idea to try to quantify what resources we've been expending, even if part of it is just, you know, labor. Just, you know, it would be good to inform the commissioner or Ms. Hopkins of, you know, the resources that we're basically putting out in order to deal with this problem.
We'll do that.
Yeah.
And, you know, on that note, I will remind everybody that the commissioner is coming to visit us on September 20th. You know, as always, we will welcome our guests. I think we have a lot of questions for the commissioner, certainly not just about a charter. There's a lot of things happening, a lot of things he wants to share about the next generation MCAS 2.0, about digital literacy, about our, you know, curriculum. There's lots of discussion that we will have with the commissioner. It'll start out with a forum, which is our kickoff for the Brockton Kids Count campaign. That'll be from 6 to 7. We would like to take a break from 7 to 7:30 because we'll be leaving the red cafeteria area here at Brockton High School, where we can accommodate many people. Those of you that attended the kickoff at the Arnone School back in the springtime know that the parking was tough to get people into that cafeteria, so we'd like to have it here at Brockton High. Parking is much more available. We'll certainly have our school police here that evening directing, and the the commissioner does want to hear from the public. He does want to hear comments about our district, and certainly he can answer any questions that the public would have. At the same time, if we give a break from 7 to 7:30, it allows us to regroup here for our regularly scheduled school committee meeting. I will be co-presenting with him that evening. We've also invited our city council, or will be, the invitations are going out. We'll invite our legislative delegation. I've invited some of the college presidents we work closely with. So we'll have a team here. I think the commissioner needs to see how we operate as a team with some of the challenges that we have faced, you know, during the past couple of years. So that will be on the 20th, and as I said, we'll be getting all that information out and preparing ourselves for questions that we might want to ask the commissioner. And also, I want to update you on the NAACP forum that we attended. I want to thank those that were able to be there that evening. Mr. Minicello, myself, and I think Mr. Thomas, our Deputy Superintendent Thomas, had an opportunity to speak. The one thing that I commit to you is that we are putting together, I've had conversations with Steve Bernard, the president of the NAACP. I believe he's leaving that role soon. But we're going to be sitting down. I'm going to ask Dr. Moran in HR to designate an HR administrator to serve on this task force, I'm going to call it. I would like a school committee member on the task force. I've already started to speak to the college presidents because it really is, it's a much bigger picture. It isn't just about applying for a job. It's more than that. It's about when you look at our students at Brockton High School, they could certainly come into our teaching force here, and we would welcome them into our teaching force. But I've talked to Bridgewater State University, Massasoit. There are things that we can do to encourage them. It's a big picture of inviting businesses to come on board. So I do not want to go before this group again unless we have some things that we can measure this year. It might, and we've been working on this, but I want to bring people from the community. So when we sit down, it isn't just the school department, it involves people in the community, and we'll talk about what this looks like. And it'll be a working group. It'll be a working group in every sense of that word, that we'll come up with an action plan for this year. We'll have data to back up what we're doing when we're talking about marketing and interviewing and putting jobs out there and really encouraging people to come in at levels of a paraprofessional, an MTA, working towards getting that teaching certification, sometimes in those hard-to-fill areas. So we will work very hard. We'll also work with our future teacher clubs. I need them supported at every level. You know, those are the clubs that take priority at our middle school, at our high school. Do we have opportunities for those students to be visiting colleges, to be having assistance? I ask the teachers on opening day. I ask them to help me to encourage kids to go into teaching. It's a wonderful occupation. It has been a truly rewarding career for me, and I'm sure I'm speaking for everybody out there that have been teachers in the Brockton Public Schools. So we've got some work ahead of us, but we are committed to getting some of this done this year. And
you want to say something about budget update? Or
the budget update, we're going to meet on the 13th. I've asked, again, Aldo Petronio to take a look at those monies. I do want to talk to you about some priority positions, and I'll address that in the Finance Subcommittee meeting next Tuesday evening.
Okay. Items to refer to subcommittee.
Okay.
I know we have to schedule a superintendent's contract review subcommittee meeting. I'll talk to Ms. Alves tomorrow about some available dates.
We're looking to garner those Tuesdays. So the Tuesdays that we're not in school committee to use those for some of our subcommittee meetings. Okay. I know I talked to you this evening about looking at the student registration procedures, policy, because it does affect transportation. So I think we need to be looking under policy and talking about our zones as we look at those numbers. We definitely need to talk about facilities. We have a discussion about the Foster Street warehouse facility. I know we've got some discussion on that. I believe we already have that date set for, I think it's the, is it the 27th? I think it's the 27th.
We talked about it.
Okay. I think we have to solidify those dates.
And the evaluation,
we're going to do those both on the 27th if people are available. That's the Tuesday evening.
Okay, great. Okay, anything else under items to refer to subcommittee?
I just want to bring to your attention, I mentioned this at the opening day, Dr. Tarasi, who has worked for many, many years on our trauma-sensitive schools tirelessly, has been invited. We're very proud to go to the White House. He's going to represent us at a forum there, I believe late September. So September 19th, he will be in Washington, D.C., representing the Brockton Public Schools. Thank you, Dr. Tarasi. Also, I know President of the BEA, Kim Gibson, certainly has been talking to the teachers. Those of you, we do have a ballot question coming up. I've certainly talked about the charter expansion, separate from our discussion right now. I know I see signs sprouting up. I would like to be able to get signs. I'm not sure if any of you would like to make sure that we have those on the lawns. Kim, I don't know if you want to address us on that, or you'll have that available through the teachers. So we could certainly use some support for that. As I said, when you talk about certainly, you know, your vote, you know, we're talking about concern about local accountability. You've heard me talk about this, and this is an example of those concerns. We've talked about separate and unequal education, and we've also talked about certainly the loss of funding. Those are three things that people need to take into account. And when I hear those ads out there, and we're starting to see them with a presidential election coming up, you know, one of the things that we want to make sure is when you talk about Brockton Kids Count, we're looking to get parents registered to vote, make sure their voice is heard, and to understand when you're watching those commercials, at least 98% of the students, you know, in our state, and you're going to hear the commissioner talk about we are number one in the nation for public education. And that education, 98%, is based on K-12. Those are public schools like Brockton. There is no need to expand that cap. So we will make sure that you can have signs, bumper stickers, if you can help out, canvassing, making sure that word is getting out there. It would certainly be appreciated.
Unfinished business? Anything under unfinished business, anyone? No? Okay. New business? The mayor, unfortunately, couldn't be here tonight. He's feeling under the weather, so it was my privilege to fill in for him. Two quick things. With regard to the meeting at Mount Moriah Baptist Church and the NAACP invitation, I thought that the Brockton Public Schools was well represented. I think the superintendent did an outstanding job for the district. People after the presentation came up to her and complimented her on her frankness and willingness to openly answer all the questions that were asked. So I thought she did wonderful. Secondly, I was able to attend the convocation, and I thought that the presentation, again, by the superintendent was wonderful. I was very impressed by Lieutenant Mills. At the very end, when people thought they were leaving, they were called back, but I think Donnie really entertained with his presentation. I thought people really learned a lot. I think it was a great presentation, a great forum to do it, in terms of defining the different terminology, and also Donnie really spelling out, when this happens, you don't do this, you do this. When that happens, do this, not that. I mean, you know, the difference between lockdown and stay in place is huge, and when the different items come up, how you react needs to meet, you know, which item is being discussed. So Donna, you did a great job. Michael was quite entertaining as the MC. So it was a very good convocation. I think people were not bored, which is always good, and you did a great job.
Yeah, even though I was long-winded, as you said.
Oh, it was effective.
Even though Deputy Thomas
it was effective.
Zinged me. So he'll get another letter in his file, Mr. Sullivan.
I was trying to think back where I was in my Brockton
so
public
did,
school
so did
career.
So Lieutenant Mills, now that I think
yes,
of
he
it.
Did. He did. He did. I didn't pile on because I think I was in high school when you came into the Brockton Public Schools. So, yeah, I wasn't at East, but I think I was at BHS. So, anyone else? Mr. Gormley.
I'd just like to encourage everybody to attend a sporting event. The fall season had started today. As we drove in, we saw the soccer team. I think it was the men's soccer team was playing. And there's a football game this Friday. And it's going to be beautiful. It'll be 70 after being 90 all day. Nice. So it's a great time to get out and watch soccer and football, field hockey. What am I missing? Mr. Thomas, did I miss anything? What else do we have in the fall?
Track.
Cross-country track. So please get out and support our young athletes. We have hundreds literally right now participating. So it's great to see people that aren't parents at the games and community members supporting our young athletes. So.
The superintendent was also speaking to Mr. McCreener outside on the steps before we came in, and you know, she asked him how many kids are in your marching band, and he said well over 200 now. So, you know, at the sporting events, the football game, it's always a treat to see the band, and you know, this year there'll be some new music, so that should be interesting in terms of the new routine. So, if you're interested in that aspect of our activities in Brockton, you know, certainly come out for the halftime show. I'm sure it'll be entertaining as usual. So,
best halftime show in the state.
Absolutely.
Okay. And the other thing we have here is coming up this weekend on Saturday, September 10th, is the Remember September Music Festival. Our own Aiden Reardon and a number of his classmates here at Brockton High, I think some of them are sophomores and juniors, have put together a music festival. And they've also chosen the Fraternal Order of Firefighters and Military Veterans as their official charity from this event. And they want to make sure that we never forget, of course, 9/11, which we will not. But these are young kids doing the right thing, you know, putting our community on the map. I believe the tickets are, general admission is $20 pre-sale, $25 at the door. And it's an afternoon filled with music from 12:30 to 11:30 p.m. So it's not just an afternoon, it goes well into the evening.
Great. Anyone else? Okay, so there's no need for executive session this evening, correct?
Correct.
Okay, motion to adjourn, anyone?
Motion to adjourn.
Seconded? All in favor? Thank you for attending.